I said we'd look a little bit at the fact that in Genesis chapter 1, you've got the 6 days of creation, you've got the seventh day, which is the day of rest, that there is a little bit of a parallel between the 6 days and the six millenniums which lead to the very end. There is some parallel. It's not perfect, as you'll see, but some of it is striking. Some of it's really interesting. So I thought we'd look at that first. If you want to just, somebody just wants to read Genesis chapter 1, verse 4.
And God saw the light, and it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness.
Okay, so what they basically say is that this is the main verse or the main event for the first millennium. That verse there. They saw the light and the darkness and the light was divided. So see, if grab some of these scriptures. John chapter 3, 19 to 20. Somebody else get Ephesians 5, 8 to 11. And somebody else get Genesis 3, 22.
Oh, I can get that one.
Genesis 3. Yeah. So John 3, 19 to 20 would be as the first one.
And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed.
So, can you see in this here, in John, that there's a parallel between light and darkness and good and evil? That's really important. Have a look at Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 to 11.
We were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, providing what is acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them.
Yeah. So again, you see that same thing, that light and darkness and good and evil. Now have a look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 22.
Then the Lord God said, Behold, the man has become like one of us, to know good and evil. And now, lest he put his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever.
So man becomes aware of good and evil, light and dark. You see it? Do you get it?
Yeah.
So the light and dark is divided. So in that first millennium, if you like, the kind of the big thing is the fall. And after the fall, they become aware of light, dark, good and evil. The second millennium, the big event in the second millennium is the flood. But if you want to just turn to Genesis chapter 1 verse 6, which is the second day. Genesis 1 verse 6, day 2.
Then God said, Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters.
Okay, somebody want to read Genesis 7, 11 to 12. So the second millennium, the high point is the flood. Now what we just read there, I'm sure most of you are aware of this, is that in the early days there was the water on the ground, then you got the skies, and then you had a canopy of water outside of the atmosphere almost, all around the planet. What it says in Genesis 1:6 is that the skies will be in the midst of the waters. Now what does Genesis 7:11 to 12 say?
In the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month, on that day all the springs of the great deep burst forth,
yeah,
and the floodgates of the heavens were opened,
yeah,
and rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights.
Yeah. Okay, so that's the second millennium, if you like. The big event is the flood. The third millennium, day 3, somebody want to read Genesis 1:9?
Then God said, Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so.
Okay, Exodus 14, verse 16. So generally speaking, people say the biggest event in the third millennium is the parting of the sea. The parting of the sea, which is of course when the Israelites are free from the enemy. So Exodus 14:16.
Lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea.
Okay. Then you've got the fourth millennium. Now this is the one that I find really striking. Somebody wants to read Genesis 1:16.
Then God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also.
Somebody want to read John 1:6-9.
There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light.
Brilliant. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
You see the mirror between Genesis and John. There's two lights in Genesis, the greater light, the lesser light. There's two lights in John, the greater light, the lesser light. One is on the fourth day, the other's in the fourth millennium. It's very interesting.
Yeah.
Day five then, day five is Genesis 1:20.
Then God said, let the waters abound with an abundance of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the face of the firmament of the heavens.
Okay, so in day five, which is the fifth millennium, Acts 2:17-18, I think it is. Acts 2:17-18.
It shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams.
Okay, that's brilliant. Sorry, carry on.
And on my manservants and maidservants, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above, and signs on the earth beneath.
Okay, so the fifth millennium is the beginning of the church age. In Genesis 1:20, on the fifth day, it's water that brings life. In Acts chapter 2, God pours out his Holy Spirit and it brings life. Day 6 is one. So day 6, Genesis 1:28.
Then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth.
Okay, Revelation 13:7. So this is the end of this 6,000 years, if you like. Remember, a day is like a thousand years, a thousand years like a day. We'll look at that.
And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all the kindreds and the tongues and the nations.
Yeah, so can you see that? That we were to subdue the earth and we fell. And there's a time when the Antichrist himself is given a period of time where he will subdue the earth. So that's what you've got there. And then in day 7, Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 to 2.
Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done.
Okay, Revelation chapter 20, verses 1 to 2.
Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years.
1,000 years. So Psalm 90, verse 4. And if somebody wants to find 2 Peter 3:8. Psalm 90, verse 4, 2 Peter 3:8.
But beloved, do not forget this one thing, that with the Lord, one day is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day.
Remember, the context of that is the mocking and so on of the last days. And what does Psalm 90 say? Psalm 93. Says the same thing, basically.
For a thousand years in thy sight, are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night.
Okay, so let's go back to Genesis chapter 6 now. So that's mildly interesting, and you know, it's relatively interesting. There's no way you can use that to prove anything, dates wise. Obviously, not a chance. Generally speaking, people say there's 2,000 years from Adam to Abraham, 2,000 years from Abraham to Jesus, and definitely 2,000 years from Jesus to now. But these are very loose dates. So the idea that you could possibly pinpoint any kind of dates in this is ridiculous. But it is interesting, particularly that day four, you've got the big light, and you've got the smaller light, and the fourth millennium you've got. It is very, very interesting. But it's nothing more than that. So let's go back to Genesis chapter 6 for a second. And this is what we've been looking at. Now it came about when men began to multiply on the face of the land and daughters were born to them that the sons of God, we looked at that last week, angels, saw that the daughters of men were beautiful and they took wives for themselves whoever they chose. Then the Lord said, my spirit will not strive with man forever because he is also flesh. Nevertheless, his days shall be 120 years. And the only other time, really, that you see these two numbers come together like this, the Spirit of God, and 120 is in Acts chapter 2. It does allude to it, actually, in Solomon's temple as well. But in Acts chapter 2, we see almost the fulfillment of this. What's interesting is that here, the Holy Spirit is saying, I will not tolerate this. I'm not going to carry on convicting in this mess. Somehow the Holy Spirit lifts and God brings about that destruction. But what it seems to point to in Acts chapter 2 is the giving of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit was given. And there's two main numbers. There's 120 people on the day of Pentecost, and Pentecost means 50. Yeah. Now, if you multiply 120 by 50, you get 6,000, which is very interesting. Yeah. But it's nothing more than interesting. I find it interesting because they are planning something big for the anniversary of the church. The world is not a celebration of the church. They're trying to bring things in by 2030, which would be around about the anniversary of the church, 2,000 years, which could be around about 6,000 years, something like that. Okay, now we're going to get on now to the role of the Holy Spirit in the last days. So have a look at John chapter 16. John chapter 16, verse 7. Well, if you want to read from John 16, verses 5 to 7.
And now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you asketh me, whither goest thou? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you.
Amazing. So Jesus makes it clear here that the Holy Spirit can't come unless he goes. Now that is really interesting. Now when we get to John chapter 20, verse 22, I think it is. What we see in John 20, 22... is what we read about, I don't know if it was last week now or the week before, God breathing the breath of life into Adam and Adam becoming a living being. Now this is immediately after his resurrection, which is quite incredible. Somebody want to read that?
And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit.
Now this is really interesting. So immediately after the resurrection, Jesus breathes on them and they receive the Holy Spirit. And clearly, this is the point when the individuals, if they like, they get born again. When you get saved, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. At point of salvation, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Now then, have a look at Luke chapter 24, verse 46.
Then
he said to them, "Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high."
Very interesting, because he's already breathed on them. And they've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. But he's saying here now, wait in Jerusalem until you are clothed. Enduo is the same word that's used for put on the whole armour of God. Same word, enduo. Okay, have a look at Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Verse 1-3.
"The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God."
So, you've got 40 days there, haven't you? Now, from Passover to Pentecost is how many days?
50
days. So what's 50 take away 40? 10 days, right? So there's 10 days that they are waiting. So they've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. They belong to Christ, but they are waiting. What are they waiting for? They're waiting to be empowered by the Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit to come upon them. So it says, "And gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, which he said, 'You have heard of me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now.' So when they had come together, they were asking, saying, 'Lord, is it at this time you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel?' And he said to them, 'It's not for you to know the times or the epochs, which the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, to the uttermost ends of the earth.'" Before the infilling, the clothing of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, they were locking themselves indoors and they didn't have a lot to offer. In fact, if you look at Peter before this point and after, he's like a different man. Particularly when he starts to preach, you think, wow, where's this coming from? Where is this understanding of the scriptures coming from? But have a look in Acts chapter 2. So in Acts chapter 2, it says, "When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting." I think the fact that they were sitting kind of tells you that they were quite relaxed. This was something that was going to happen. All they had to do is wait. And when the day of Pentecost had fully come, and as I think we looked at last week, Christ fulfills the feasts. So he fulfilled the feast of Passover upon the cross, didn't he? He filled the feast of unleavened bread. He's sinless. He fulfilled the feast of first fruits through his resurrection 3 days later. The church fulfills Pentecost, if you like. From a Jewish point of view, the law was given on this day. And when the law was given on this day, they say in their tradition that there were 70 different languages that went forth and kind of spoke to them and asked them if they would receive this or not. Would they receive the law or not? We don't know whether that's true or not. What we do know is that 3,000 died at the giving of the law, and we know that 3,000 were saved here. That's the parallel. That's what the scriptures tell us. So this is what we have. We have a very meek, powerless church that were locking themselves indoors. And this is the whole point of this study. This study is not to prove the gifts of the Spirit or to make out who's more spiritual than somebody else. This study is because we are going to need the Holy Spirit in the days to come. We're going to need the strength that comes only from the Holy Spirit. That's why we're doing this study. So look, let's go to 1 Thessalonians for a minute. 1 Thessalonians 1, 5 to 6. Now, this is really important. I just have to have a quick... Somebody, just grab us a drinker. Brilliant. Go on.
Our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost, and in much assurance, as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that ye were ensamples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia.
Okay, that's fine. This is really important. You'll see in a minute why. He says, for our gospel did not come to you in word only. We were talking about this earlier on. We were talking about people preaching the gospel earlier on. And, you know, I've been to a few funerals in this last couple of years where I've heard the pastor say, such and such a person says, I've got to preach the gospel, so you're all without excuse. I'm going to bring the gospel. And they never bring the gospel. I've seen it so many times. They never actually bring the gospel. So it goes along the lines of, Jesus loves you, so you need to make a decision. That is not the gospel. The gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. The gospel is the fact that we are all sinners. Every single one of us have sinned. We've fallen short of the glory of God. That God sent his only son into this world for sinners, of which everybody is a sinner. And he sent his son for all of us, for all sinners. His son bore our sins upon the cross. He died upon the cross. He cried out, it is finished, upon the cross. And he got the victory, and the principalities were made a public spectacle of through the cross. That's the gospel. And the command is to repent and believe the gospel. That's the command. Paul says, for our gospel did not come to you in word only. Now, this is why I said on Sunday, there's a vacuum in the land. There's a vacuum because people aren't even, I'm telling you, folks, and I'm not saying this to stir up trouble, people don't even know what the gospel is. There are people that have been in the ministry 10 years. They don't know what the gospel is. If you say to them, preach the gospel, they bring something, but it's not the gospel. But it wasn't just the gospel that was brought to this church. It was the power of the Spirit. Right, so it says here, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit. Listen, with full conviction. With full conviction. Just as you know what kind of man we prove to be among you for your sake. The gospel came with power and the Holy Spirit brought conviction. And you've got people today not preaching the gospel because they don't want to offend. People need to be offended. Yeah. They need to know they're sinners in order to get saved. So what it tells us is, and John tells us, that one of the major roles of the Holy Spirit is to convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment to come. This is really important to the end times, to what we're going to look at. My spirit will not contend with men forever. 120 years, I'm going to turn this place upside down. There was order and God brought this chaotic mess again and it went back to this watery abyss with only 8 people saved in an ark. But the gospel comes to these people not just in word, but by the Holy Spirit with convicting power. I would rather, and I've done funerals here. I've done funerals here where you go to the wake after, and nobody will speak to you. you go to the wake and you shake the hand, hello, don't want to know. Because they've come under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And it's not nice, it's horrible. I did a funeral in Manchester not that long ago. The woman says to me, she says, as long as you mention Manchester City and Manchester United at the start, you can say anything you want after that. So I did. I mentioned Man City and Man United and I gave them both barrels. Honestly, the lot, heaven, hell, the lot. And every single one of them stood there, jaw dropped. They'd never heard the gospel before. They'd never heard the gospel before. And we think people, we assume they know the gospel. They don't. They don't know the gospel. But the gospel came to this church in power. Not just in word, but in power. And the Holy Spirit was convicted. And that's why this church was planted. Now look at 1 Thessalonians 4. 1 Thessalonians 4, 13.
But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope.
Carry on, all the way down to verse 18.
For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
It's lovely. By the way, how well did Kevin do Sunday night? It was really, and it was very appreciated online. Really appreciated online. So Paul talks a lot about being uninformed, as though he's talking about those who've fallen asleep. That means those that have already died. And, you know, we went to a fantastic funeral yesterday with Jean. I mean, it was packed. I have no idea how many. I'm guessing 200 people. Something like that, do you think? Somewhere along that line. Because it was full in the other room as well. And I was looking at various ones. People that, you know, really inspired me when I was a young Christian. I mean, the old pastor was there. 90 years of age is now. 90 years of age. And a woman called Sheila, we used to have prayer. We used to go around Sheila's just for extra prayer meetings, you know, because we couldn't get enough. So we used to go all mob round Sheila, Cynthia and Alan as well. Not Alan, because he wasn't saved then, but we'd all bob around and we'd have... So Sheila was at 90 years of age. She's on fire. Mm-hmm. She's on fire.
Yeah.
90 years of age. But they are going to fall asleep.
Yeah.
They are. They won't be here for long. They will not be here for long. And I'm glad they won't.
Yeah.
I really am. I'm glad. I'm glad that there's people in our lives that have had such a wonderful effect on us. The godly people are not going to see these times as they begin to unfold. The Lord is taking faithful people one by one. Jean Nicholson was an incredible woman of God. Incredible woman of God. I mean, Jean, just out of way, she only had to look at you.
Yeah.
And you knew.
Yeah.
You knew with Jean, just one look. And boy, and there's a lady, I got to know the lady that used to pick her up, a Jamaican lady, who used to pick her up late.
Yeah. On time. Which
well,
is late.
Yeah. Anyway, the point is, we are, these people, they are slipping into the presence of God. And heaven's better for them, but we aren't. And they're going one by one. But Jesus said, "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain," and everybody wants to be there for the rapture, but the rapture will come to us all in one way or another,
yes.
Whether we're dead in Christ or whether we're there. And the truth of the matter is, most of us will be dead, probably. And I don't mind. I haven't got a problem with that. I'm not one of these that, I'm going to be there, the Lord. I've got this witness burning in my bosom that I'm going to be there for the rapture. I'm not bothered whether I'm going the rapture, being taken from the grave. Or what? I just want to go to heaven.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter about how you get there.
Right.
Yeah. Well, this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of our Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with the shout. And you see all this scattered through the scriptures in the most amazing ways. It was. Remember with Joshua, there was a shout.
Yes.
There was a shout and there was a trumpet. And yes. Then after the shout and the trumpet, the walls fall in and Rahab gets saved and Jericho gets judged. So there's the shout with the voice of the archangel and there's a trumpet. And we know in 1 Corinthians 15:51 that the rapture happens at the last trumpet. That's the pretty much the only scripture we have that really deals with the timing of the rapture is 1 Corinthians 15:51 that tells us it is the last trumpet. Now, I'll just tell you this while we're looking at it. So there were 10 days leading up to Pentecost, 10 days, right? And in those 10 days, the church had no power and all they were doing is waiting. They were in the upper room and they were waiting. And suddenly they weren't ready. They didn't necessarily know when it was coming. Seems to me that they were fairly relaxed, but suddenly the Holy Spirit turns up. Well, there's 10 days at the end, beginning in the seventh month, on the first of the seventh month, all the way through to Yom Kippur. There's 10 days, they're called the 10 days of awe, and they lead to Yom Kippur. Yeah. And those days are designed for people to get themselves right with the Lord because the Day of Atonement is coming. So there's 10 days at the beginning, there's 10 days at the end, and they do pancake one another to a certain degree. So there's the trumpet, blast of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Now, you'd be amazed how many Christians don't understand that the rapture comes from the Old Testament. They think Paul has pulled this out of a hat. It's like he's just made it up. Well, he hasn't made it up. All of this stuff is in the Old Testament. The rapture is in the Old Testament. It is a mystery. And behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep with it. It's a mystery in the Old. It's concealed, but it's revealed in the new. What's concealed in the Old is revealed in the new. But it's all there. So Daniel chapter 12 talks about this. The dead in Christ will rise, those that sleep in the dust of the earth and so on and so forth. And Isaiah 25 and 26, thus shall the scripture be fulfilled. 1 Corinthians 15:51, death shall be swallowed up in victory. Yeah. Where's he quoting from? He's quoting from Isaiah. Why is he? Because the rapture's in Isaiah.
Yeah.
Anyway, then we are alive, caught up. That's the word harpazio. Harpazio, caught, snatch, like rugby tackled almost, up to heaven. You know, we're taken away by force, or those that are there will be. Where are they taken? They're taken up into the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. That's amazing. Yeah. How that is going to be, how it's going to work, I don't know. But I just can't even imagine it, can you? Any film would be so embarrassing. Have they ever tried to make a film of the rapture, like people superimposed into clouds? It just would be so nasty. It doesn't need to be done, because it won't work. But then he says, therefore, comfort one another with these words. So that's nice. And then he goes on and he says, now as, verse 5, chapter 5, now as to the times and the seasons, epochs, brethren, you have no need of anything to be written to you, for you yourselves know full well. Paul had already taught these people, right? Now, remind yourself, how did he come to them? How did he come to them?
With the gospel and power.
And with the Spirit of God, right? And what did the Spirit of God do? Convicted them. Well, if you yourselves know full well that the day of the Lord will come just as a thief in the night. There's always these metaphors of night, night, night. And when night comes, no man can work. Mm-hmm. Night, night, night. He comes as a thief in the night. It's interesting how Satan is described as a thief, but also in a way Jesus is described as a thief, because he snatches us away from the night. He snatches us out of the night.
Yes. Yeah.
While they were saying peace and safety, you know, these peace treaties, there is eventually going to be some kind of peace treaty. You look at Revelation chapter 6, what's the first white horse? He comes along, you know, conquering. But the second one, the red horse, takes away the peace. So clearly the white horse brings peace because it's taken away in the second horse. What people don't know is, for instance, 2 Thessalonians is a commentary on the Olivet Discourse, word for word almost, and they don't see it. They don't see that what Paul's talking about in 2 Thessalonians 2 is practically word for word what Jesus describes in Matthew 24 and Luke 21. And also Revelation chapter 6, they're all in the same order. They're all in the same order. Now, this is not something that we fall out about. We don't need to fall out about this. We can agree to disagree on the timing of the rapture, but I've always said this, my conscience will not let me teach something that I'm not comfortable teaching. And I'm not comfortable teaching a pre-trib rapture. And you'll just have to let me do these next couple of weeks to explain why. I am absolutely convinced that the church is going to go into some very, very difficult times. And he wants us to be ready, mentally ready. In fact, when it talks about warfare in the New Testament, warfare is not against principalities. It's the warfare in your own head. When he's talking about warfare, it's what's going on up there. You've got to win those battles in your head first. So for you yourself know that when the day of the Lord, it will come just like a thief in the night. When they say peace and safety, then destruction will come upon them suddenly, like labor pains. Notice that again. Matthew 24 talks about labor pains. You see it again here. Well, what happens with labor pains? Well, you think it's all right. And then you get people saying, well, you know, I'm not bothered about I don't need to know about the Antichrist or the tribulation. I'm just waiting for Jesus. Well, that's like a woman saying, I don't care about the labor pains. I'm not interested in them. I just want the baby. Well, you have to go through the labor pains to get the baby. And it's part of it. And it makes the baby that much more precious. Anyway, the thing about labor pains is they come and go. So you get a bit of respite. You know, and then the next one tends to be a little bit more intense. And then off they go, and until eventually, press the panic button. And it's not, you know, it's not easy for us men. I tell you, I had Mandy drew blood in my hand.
Is that the only thing?
And she'd got all this gas in her. One minute she's laughing and giggling, right? Honestly, she was laughing the hospital down. It was so funny. Next minute she's screaming in pain and squeezing my hand too hard. And then the lady said, "You see that red button over there?" I said, "You what, the one with the emergency written on?" She says, "Yes, that one. Just press it for me, love." And there was blood everywhere, you know. But then we had little Josiah, you know, with this little mop of hair. And you know, my prayer was, "Please, Lord, if it's going to be a boy, don't let him look like me." When he came out, I thought, "Thank God for that. Thank God for that. He hasn't got ginger hair."
No ginger.
We needed a brown baby.
No. He did. Oh, yeah, because of Leroy. So labour pains are inescapable, folks. It's part of life. But you, brethren, are not in darkness that the day would overtake you like a thief, because we will understand. Yes. It tells us in Daniel, the wise will understand. Yeah. The wicked will not understand. But you, brethren, are not in the dark. I've just said that. For you are all sons of light and the sons of the day, and we are not of the night nor of the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but let us be alert and sober. For those who sleep do not do their sleeping at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we are of the day, let us be sober. Notice this now. Notice this now. The armour of God? Yeah? Yeah. The armour of God comes in where? In what phase do we need the armour of God in? As it gets dark. Having put on the breastplate of faith and love and the helmet and hope of salvation. By the time he writes Ephesians 6, he's got this nailed. He's just practicing at it here. For God has not destined us for wrath.
No.
Now that word wrath is orge. He's not destined us for wrath, right? That's important. He's not destined the church for wrath. However, Paul tells us in the book of Acts, through many tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of heaven. And the word is phlipsis, and the great tribulation is mega phlipsis, great tribulation. But the promise is, and we're not going to look at this week, we haven't got time, we'll look at it next week. But the promise is, we are not destined for the wrath of God.
No.
Now that's wonderful. How can we, you know, praise the Lord for that, by the way. That we, you know, thank the Lord for that. We're not destined for the wrath of God. Praise the Lord. But are we going to see the other things? Yeah, probably. Now, we all have a different take on this as to where it is. Let me get through this. And because I've got something I want to share at the end, which is very important. And then next week, as we start to talk about the timing a bit more, we'll just have a bit more time and talk about it and just kind of see what we can come to. But it says, God has not destined us for wrath, but for the obtaining of salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. Now then, so now we're ready to look at 2 Thessalonians, right? 2 Thessalonians 2. How are we doing for time? Right. Okay. Now, I'm going to draw. Let me draw. I'm not very good at drawing. Let me just draw something very quickly. A big R for rapture. An A for apostasy, and then an even bigger A for the Antichrist. Right? Apostasy, Antichrist, rapture.
Yeah.
Right? See that? Apostasy, Antichrist, rapture. So let's have a look at this. Now we request you, brethren, with regard to the coming of our Lord, parousia, of our Lord Jesus Christ, and our gathering, which is episynagoge, which is where we get the word synagogue from. Yeah. Our gathering together to him. In 1 Thessalonians 4, what happens? Where do we meet him?
At
In the clouds. We meet him in the clouds. He comes in the air. He comes, parousia, to the clouds. And then we meet him there. So our episynagogue, our gathering together to him. Now this is, everybody wants to talk about the timing. And they miss this bit. That you not be quickly shaken from your composure. We have to keep our composure. You know, nobody wants a surgeon coming up to them saying, this is stressing me out. It's like, I've had a look at the scans. I'm really nervous about this. Pray for me. I'm going in. I've never done this before. Nobody wants that. You want composure, is what you want. But where does composure come from? How can you have composure when everything is just falling to pieces? You shall not be quickly... Hebrews tells us once again, I'm going to shake everything. So that whatever can be shaken will be shaken. But shaken from your composure, or to be disturbed either by a spirit. A spirit. So there are lying spirits around at that time that are saying things that are contrary to the word of God. A spirit. Or a message or a letter as if to the effect, a letter as if from us. Yeah. So people basically saying, you know, this is the Apostle Paul speaking. And they're putting, I don't know what they're doing. But this will happen again. As though the day of the Lord had come. And then he says, let no one deceive you. Now, in Matthew chapter 24, which this is a commentary of. Yes. This letter is a commentary of the Olivet Discourse. The first thing it says is, do not be deceived.
That's right.
Yeah. Don't be deceived. Yeah, totally. That's the first thing. Four times. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Don't be deceived in any way. For it will not come unless the apostasy comes first. So, and then it goes on and it talks about the man of lawlessness being revealed, the son of perdition, and the only other son of perdition is Judas. So we know that the Antichrist is in some way like Judas, which is beyond the what's its scope of this study. But there is an apostasy coming. Now, have a look. There's lots of scripture on apostasy. Just turn to 2 Peter 2 for a minute. 2 Peter 2, 1.
But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction.
Now this is a mammoth of a chapter. It's huge. People say that Peter was a fisherman and he was relatively thick compared to Paul. I don't see that. When I look at this here, this guy is filled with the Holy Spirit, and my goodness me, his insight is unreal. So he says, for false prophets arose among the people, just as there were also false teachers among you, who secretly introduced destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them. Now that word bought there is used in Corinthians. You were bought with a price. It's where we get the word redeemed from. You were bought with a price. You are the temple of God. You were bought with, twice in Corinthians, it says, you were bought with a price. The same word is used in Revelation chapter 5 when God purchases people by his blood. Yes. He's purchased them by his blood. So he says the people in those days, talking about the days that we're going into, are going to come in bringing about destructive heresies, denying the master who bought them. Who purchased them? And what's going to happen to them? Bringing swift destruction upon themselves. That's what's going to happen to them. There's so many warnings in the scripture. Many will follow their sensuality. Because of them, the way of truth will be maligned. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. Their judgment from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. For God did not spare the angels. And he compares these men to angels. You know, you see, you have to understand, folks. Lucifer was perfect. And he chose to rebel in his perfection. He was the anointed cherub that chose to rebel. Peter compares these ones to angels that chose to follow him. Now, we're not going through the whole chapter because it's too much. But let's just go to the end of the chapter. This is what it says in verse 20. For if after they have escaped the defilements of the world by the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and they are again entangled in them and are overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first. For it would be better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn away from the holy commandment handed to them. It has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, a sow after washing turns to the wallowing of the mire. Now there's lots of scriptures that talk about this, but there is coming an apostasia. And one of the reasons why it's coming is because people will be challenged to deny their Lord. I like John MacArthur. I like him. As a Bible teacher, I like him. I thought he did very well during COVID. But John MacArthur actually said, you can take the mark of the beast and you'll be okay. Now, if you look at what the scripture says about that, that's not what the scripture teaches. And what happens is, taking of the mark coincides with the worship of Satan. And what's going to happen at the end is people will be forced to deny Christ. And it says there'll be those that will be like dogs returning to their vomit. Yes. And I've told you this before. I've seen that firsthand.
Yes.
I took a guy to go and have a meal and hear the gospel. And we fed him with this lovely meal. And right with his front table. And while this guy's giving the gospel and he's eating all this lovely food up, in front of 100 people all sitting at tables, he puked the lot back onto his plate. And I thought, oh my goodness, I can't believe he's just done that. I bought him. He was my guest. Then he ate it all back up again. He scoffed the lot back in his mouth, all of it, every bit, because he was on monkey dust. There is a falling away coming, folks. And there's a huge challenge coming at the church to deny him. And the early church, the reason why the early church went through what they went through is because they did not want to deny him. Now, how on earth, and this is, I'm not trying to make some clever points here, folks. I'm serious about what's coming. And how are we supposed to not deny him unless we have the power not to deny him?
So
it tells us that there is an apostasia, right? It's mentioned in Timothy and all different places. People are going to become lovers of themselves and all this stuff, right? But it's not just that. The lawless one will be revealed. So two things. Paul says, I don't want you to be shaken. Don't let anybody tell you the rapture's happened. Because that's what they were saying about then. They'll be saying it again. Because it says in Matthew 24, if they say Jesus is out in the desert, do not go out there. Don't think that this has already happened. It hasn't. Because when he comes, it's going to be like lightning going across the sky. You'll know. So here Paul says, don't be deceived. There has to be an apostasia and there has to be the revealing of the Antichrist. And then And then we call it the rapture. The word is harpazio, right? Yes. The snatching away. Yes. And then we meet him in the cloud. In other words, two things have to happen.
Yeah.
Okay. But then it starts getting complicated. Now, that's why I've done it in two parts. Right, so this is where people struggle. And I'll tell you why they struggle. I'm standing up, look. So they struggle. They struggle because in our minds, we think that when the Holy Spirit goes, we must go at the same time. Right? We must go at the same time. Now, I'm going to show you something on the chart in a minute. All right, let's get back to this. Now, let me read it, right? So, the apostasia comes and the lawless one is revealed. It's revealed. Who has wisdom? Who's going to calculate? Who's going to find out who this man is? Jesus revealed Judas. The disciples didn't know who Judas was. Jesus revealed Judas. And Jesus will reveal to the church at some point who the Antichrist is. We are not in the dark. As soon as those two events happen, there's nothing stopping the church from going. That doesn't mean the church is going to immediately go, mind. But there's nothing stopping the church from going. But this is where it starts to get a little bit deeper, right? So, okay. The man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself to be God. In the time of the Maccabees, there was no Ark of the Covenant. There was no restrainer. There was no presence. It's the same. The ark wasn't there when Jeremiah. There's no presence. There's no restrainer. So they come in and they take this stuff away. That's a shadow. That's a type. So what it says here is, do you not remember that while I was still with you, I told you these things? What things? Well, he says, I did not come to you just with word. I came to you with the gospel and the Holy Spirit in convicting power. And then he says, and now you know what restrains. There is a restrainer. Jesus tells us the role of the Holy Spirit is to convict the world of sin, of righteousness, of judgment to come. Have you not noticed? Or am I the only one that's noticed? I know I'm not. That people don't feel that conviction. When you start to talk to people, that moral thing of right and wrong and sin, it's not there like it used to be. Something is changing. And he says, do you not know? He says that I told you about these things, and now you know what restrains him, so that in his time he will be revealed. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Ephesians 6:12, we see these facets, these layers of clouds, dark, menacing clouds. It's the mystery of lawlessness. They've been hell-bent on world domination ever since way back, Tower of Babel. God has not allowed them to do what... There comes a time when God allows that to happen. But the mystery of lawlessness has always been there, but it's been pushed back.
Yes.
It's like when you get two opposing magnets, and there's this, you can feel this fight between them. Or a dam. You see these incredible dams holding back billions of tons of energy, water. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work, only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way, and then the lawless one will be revealed. So what Paul is saying here is, I'm just trying to paraphrase, right? What Paul is saying here is this. Something has to go in order for the Antichrist to come. The mystery of lawlessness has always been with us. I think we can talk to non-Christians, and that most people will admit the world is getting worse and worse and worse.
Yeah.
Morals are getting worse and worse and worse. Yeah. Everybody understands that. Now, the word taken away here doesn't mean taken up. It means... Right. When I was a young man, going out in the pubs, right, there was this particular girl that I always fancied. But there was another guy who fancied her as well. And he was an ex-paratrooper, right? Well, this went on for... And he was always threatening me. And this one... No, but, you know, I reckon that I could have got her over him, you know, so there was this kind of thing. Anyway, so there's this one night, and it's all over this girl. And I'd had one too many beers, right? So I said to him, look, I'm sick of this. Let's have it out. Me and you. Let's have it out. My mates, up until that point, were restraining this ex-paratrooper from hitting me. Right? Until I said, let's have it out. Let him go. Let's have this out. I didn't even get through the sentence before this guy head-butted me so hard that he split my nose, broke my nose in two places, and I was on the ground going, aah! I was in hospital that night because my nose was broken in two places, right? I thought, with a different kind of spirit than the Holy Spirit... that I could actually have a go at this guy. No, he basically knocked me out. Funny enough, the next week, there was a friend of mine called Dominic Thwaite. And the next week I went out, or was it the week after? I can't remember now. Dominic had a big nose anyway. And I said, what on earth has happened to you? His nose was like that. He says, I won't tell you his name in case he ever listens. He might batter me again. But anyway, the same guy had done the same thing to him. Bang! Just did not even bother with the hands. They call it the scouse kiss. The scouse kiss. Bang! Splat! Your nose is gone. But they let go. They let go.
Yeah.
And that was it. They let go and splat. Yeah. I was on the floor. Is that a nice illustration? So, what happens is, my spirit will not strive with men forever. Right? It won't. In the days of Noah.
Yeah.
Wickedness. The word violence is Hamas.
Yeah.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
That the word violence is Hamas?
Yeah.
Well, anyway, so what it kind of really means is the Holy Spirit kind of steps aside in terms of restraining.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the Holy Spirit steps aside. This allows the Antichrist to come. When the Antichrist has come, there's nothing stopping the church from going. That doesn't mean that the church is immediately going to go, but there's nothing else to happen. Once that's happened, once the restrainer has stepped aside. Now this is... Anyway, I should have thought this through a bit more. But Luke, the Holy Spirit is never going to leave you. It says in Matthew chapter 28, I will never leave you nor forsake you, even till the end of the age, right? So do you see that right back in the beginning, Jesus breathed on them. He breathed on them. They received the seal of the Holy Spirit. They had the seal of the Spirit in them. But he said, I want to clothe you in a power that will impact even the Roman Empire.
Yeah.
But that came 10 days later. They had to wait. They had to wait. Well, at the end of time, the opposite happens. So at the beginning of the church, Jesus has to go for the Holy Spirit to come.
Yeah.
At the end, the Holy Spirit has to step aside so that Jesus will come. And Jesus can't come unless the restrainer goes. It's the opposite. At the beginning, there was 10 days. 10 days, they were powerless for 10 days. They were waiting upon the Lord. They locked themselves indoors. Go read Isaiah 25 and 26. They're locking themselves indoors, and then comes the rapture.
Yeah.
There's no power. The rapture is almost a cesarean, really. It's a cesarean birth because the days are shortened.
Yeah.
Because if they weren't, no flesh would live.
Yeah. Yeah.
No flesh would live. So, okay, that'll do. Right, let me just show you something now. Let me just show you something now from Habakkuk, right? Let's go to Habakkuk. Time, I'm sorry about time, folks. I am. I am sorry. Habakkuk. Now, I've got to show you this. I've got to show you this. This is amazing, right? Habakkuk is about an invasion, as you know. The three chapters. Babylonian invasion. Habakkuk is alarmed. Absolutely alarmed. And rightly so, he can't understand why God would allow such evil to come. He just can't. He can't get it. And so the oracle which Habakkuk the prophet saw, "How long, O Lord, will I call for help and you will not hear? I cry out to you, Hamas." I cry out to you, Viola. By the way, that doesn't mean, you know, but it just happens to be the word. And on he goes, he says, he talks about destruction, and he's so unhappy about what's happening. This is an invasion.
Yes. Yeah.
Honestly, this is... Oh, yesterday, I went to the church. Sheila, 90 years of age, right? 90 years of age. On fire. On fire for God. She comes to me, she sees me, recognises me straight away, puts her arms around me, she says, "Do you remember when you had that dream about invasion, occupation and destruction?" She says, "It's happening, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's happening." Well, I preached that from Habakkuk when we did the church plant all those years ago.
Yeah.
She remembers it. You see, believe it or not, Habakkuk moves through three stanzas. Invasion, occupation, destruction. Right? So the first thing, invasion, Habakkuk is saying, how on earth are you allowing this to happen? Now, let me just say this, not for argument's sake, because it doesn't bother me. If I'm wrong, and those others in here that believe we're going to go into that time are wrong, right? If we're wrong, the worst that can happen is that we go up in the rapture and think, well, praise the Lord, I was wrong. Right? If people like Amir Safati are wrong, and I believe Amir Safati will change his stance completely, because I believe he's a man of God, he's got principles. If they are wrong, they're going to wake up to their worst nightmare. And that's what Habakkuk is. Habakkuk is their worst nightmare coming true. And he's got to come to terms with the fact that God is sovereign. And so he says here in chapter 2, "I will stand my guard, my post, and station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will speak to me and how I may reply when I am reproved." And the Lord answered me and said, "Record the vision and inscribe it on tablets of stone, that the one who reads it may run. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, and it hastens toward the goal, and it will not fail. Though it tarries, wait for it will certainly come."
Amen.
And this is what he says. He says this. He says, listen, write it down on tablets of stone, make it plain, and run with it. And that's what's needed today. We need to make this message where we are right now. How have we got here? What's coming in the future? What's going to happen when this peace treaty or whatever is signed? What's going to happen when we go into that period of time? What's going to happen when judgment day comes? What is heaven and hell about? Write it down on tablets of stone, make it plain and run with it.
Yeah.
Because this vision's for an appointed time. Though it tarries, it's going to come. It's going to come. And this is one of the problems. One of the problems is that people over 50, generally speaking, understand the end times better than people under 50. I'm only speaking generally here. But most of these people, like Sheila, that is on fire for God, 90 years, she's not going to be here. So she's got all this knowledge, and she's not going to be, but Generation Z, they're going to be here. And they need to know. They need to know that very, very difficult times are coming. They're coming. So we're busy equipping people that aren't going to be here, a lot of them. Right, let me show you something now at the end. Habakkuk 3. Invasion, occupation, destruction. That was the dream I had, and I'll stand by it. I believe it was a dream from the Lord. I believe that Islam is coming. It's coming to invade. It's coming to occupy, and it wants to destroy. But there's something coming after Islam, worse, that will have the same pattern: invasion, occupation, destruction. It wants to destroy, but it will not. It will not be allowed to destroy. Because God has a plan for the church. Mm-hmm. And the plan for the church is death, burial, and resurrection. Amen. We must die. Mm-hmm. We have to die. Yeah. We must be buried. And we're going to be resurrected. Yeah. They will not get to destroy the people of God. No. He who touches you touches the apple of his eye. You can't snatch them out of his hand. If we're in his hand and we willfully don't go back to our own vomit, he cannot snatch us out. He can't. No. We belong to him. Mm-hmm. We're his beloved. Yes. Now this is what it says at the end. And it's amazing. I've never had, I don't know why I'm standing up. I've never had so many people asking questions about something that I didn't think people were going to be interested in. I didn't think people would be interested in looking at the Holy Spirit. I didn't think there'd be any interest. I've never had so many emails off people. And it's always the same. These are not awkward people that want to trip you up and say, no, they're people that are saying, we know what we're going into. And we know we're not quite right. Something's not right. But we don't want to fall for this stuff that's happened before in the past. Yeah. We don't want that. We don't want to be a part of that. Yeah. We want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Yeah. But we don't know what he looks like. We don't know what it is to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. We've never been there before. See, all these things. All the people saying all these things. And quite rightly so. Yeah. These are good things to say. But there's an answer at the end of Habakkuk. So listen, listen, when Paul brought the gospel, he brought it in a narrow window. Before the three missionary journeys, there was an emperor called Caligula. He was a psycho. Yeah. The man was sick. And he was sick towards Christians. When Paul was given that mandate for the three missionary journeys, it was Claudius. And he was benevolent. He was very open and he was okay with Christianity. Immediately after him comes Nero. Psycho. Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord. And he's writing it from prison because the apostolic age is coming to an end and they're moving into a period where the Caesars are sickos. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Stand four times. Stand toe-to-toe with the enemy. Stand. How? You've got to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And stand. Because the gospel was given a window and there were signs and wonders. The gospel went forth with signs and wonders. Wonderful things happened. But the Holy Spirit moves differently through different seasons. If you go, and God forbid, right? If you look at the Spanish Inquisitions, you don't see signs and wonders. You don't see people preaching out on the streets and people getting healed and walking and leaping and praising God. You see people being empowered to stand. And that empowering is from the Holy Spirit. It's a different season. Look. And I am finishing with this. This is it. Though the fig tree should not blossom. The fig tree. You understand? Israel. And there be no fruit. There's no fruit. There's no fruit. What Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Fruit, Galatians. Listen. Though the yield of the olive should fail. The Holy Spirit. You see, at the end, he stops restraining. The power goes. If you read Daniel and Revelation, the saints are handed over, the power goes. The Holy Spirit doesn't leave them. He's not left them, but the power to restrain is gone. Even if the olive fails, the Holy Spirit and the produce in the field, though the flock should be cut off from the fold, that there be no cattle in the stalls, yet, I will rejoice in the God of my salvation. Amen. The Lord God is my strength. Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. I will joy in the God of my salvation and in the Lord of my strength. Why? Because he's made my feet like hind's feet so that I can get over my mountains. Yes. Do you see? Even though the Holy Spirit has gone, the olives have gone, the fruit's gone, the cattle have gone, there's nothing there. There is still enough to stand. Yes. And he's able to do what he can't do. Yeah. So people are thinking, oh, I won't say it like that. I don't want to mock anybody. But I'm so frightened of Toronto happening, or I'm so frightened of Pensacola happening, or this, that, or the other happening. Listen, the last proper persecution was probably under Bloody Mary.
Yeah. Yes.
We've never seen a time of persecution. People say, well, you know, what about the hippie movement? That was genuine, wasn't it? Or the Lewis revival, that was genuine. Or the Welsh revival, the thing on Mount Cop. Yes, they were all genuine revivals. But it was in a time of peace.
Yeah.
And when the Holy Spirit moves in a time of peace, it's different. It doesn't mean that there won't be miracles. It doesn't mean that God will not do incredible things. But the way we perceive it's going to be is not the way it's going to be. But he will give you hind's feet. We went to see Joan yesterday. As soon as I saw her, hope she doesn't listen to this. Joan, if you're listening, don't listen to this part. Fast forward it a few minutes. When I saw her, I thought, oh my Lord, she looks so ill. And the first thing that went through my mind was, well, at least she's going to go to heaven, and this place is getting messy anyway. And we're talking, and this is a broken vessel. You're looking at a broken vessel. She's lost loads of weight. Just absolute, the weight's gone. She's a broken clay vessel that's spilling out Christ, and Christ is in her eyes. Yeah. And she's saying to us, I don't feel the presence of God. And I'm looking at her thinking, but I can see Christ in you. And that's what it's like. That's what it was like in that 10-day period. That's what it's going to be like again. There's not going to be the sense of feeling and manifestations. But he's with us, and he will not leave us, even until the end of the age. And he will give us hind's feet, even when the olive fails.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I believe that was a word.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. Listen, shall we finish and worship the Lord together, friends? And next week, we'll look at this a little bit more. And then the week after that, we're going to look at the The geology of the flood.
Yes. Yeah.
The geology of the flood.
Yeah.
Like you go up to Lord's, not Lord's Church, you go up to the roaches.
Yeah, yeah.
And it says that it's all been under the sea 60 million years and all that. I think there is evidence of a catastrophic flood on this earth.
Yes.
That's another story. Friends, let's stand. Amen. Let's stand. And listen, remember, none of us understand this fully. Nobody does. Nobody does. But the one thing we've got in common is Christ.
Yes.
And His Amen. Blood. Amen. His blood has washed us, loosed us,
yeah.
and the Holy Spirit has sealed us. Yeah. And we need that empowering. I believe we need that empowering for boldness.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Yes.
I've got a short song. I think it's appropriate.
Go for it, Ken.
Well, when I say that saints shout, Amen, I need you all to say Amen.
Right, we'll do that.
As the coming of the Lord draws near, get ready to meet the King. He's coming on the clouds of heaven. He's coming back again. And the saints shout, Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus Christ is coming. As they rise to meet Him in the air, and the saints shout, Amen.
Amen.
Jesus Christ is coming back again.
Okay, listen, listen. I don't want to. I can't upstage that, right? That's brilliant. But I wonder if we can sing, "I will call upon the Lord." Okay. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. The God of my salvation be exalted.